people here might know me as a music guy who played in local symphony orchestras and also recorded many concerts, or know me as a preservation activist or as a writer about a lady sculptor, Vinnie Ream, a family ancestor who made a statue of Lincoln, but I really began as a machinist in the local shops. I was born in Peoria, Illinois, home of Caterpillar, but I never worked on bulldozer parts. I did work as a mechanical technician during most of my employment of 33 years. Another music guy born there was Dan Fogelberg, although he was a year or two younger. His dad, of leader of the band fame, was a music teacher in that area. It would influence what I was trying to do in music much later in the late 1970s, when I did not know of a Peoria connection. We did not live in Peoria. We lived in Eureka back then, a small town to the north where Ronald Reagan had attended college. My parents chaperoned dances at Eureka College. My dad took some 16mm movie footage of Ronnie with his Keystone wind-up camera. I would later use it too, and his Revere projector. I grew up with 16mm movie making on film technology. I showed music interest at an early age on the parlor organ, visiting Grandmother Sherwood's house. We moved southeast to Bloomington to be closer to a lumber business Dad was trying to develop, and I began school there at Oakland in 1955. But Dad died the following year on November 12, 1956, just after my 7th birthday. I began music on cello there, and at the junior high at the old high school, I got into orchestral music. My mother took me to the symphony concerts, and I played on the stage at the old consistory with them at a youth event. In an industrial arts shop class, I broke a small threading tap, and I had to buy them a new one. The small ones are the easiest to break. The next one went okay. At home, I bought a tube tester kit from Allied Radio, and bought a book on radio TV servicing. I rebuilt the amplifier in my dad's old Revere 16mm optical sound projector. I built a voltometer and a vacuum tube amplifier. That's how I got into audio. Doctors advised that I move to a drier climate. So to Colorado, Mom and I went in 1964 for my health and to finish school. Some other relatives were living here then. Longmont in 1965 only had a population of 15,000, but I needed that, and it had a very good music program. They asked me to play bass going into 10th grade at the new high school. Leo Meyer gave me two lessons and a bass for practice at home. I played in several music groups. That was me playing acoustic bass in the Longmont High School Rhythm Airs in 1968. Four of us also had a quartet. We played Take Five in the Kiwanis Stars of Tomorrow shows. I learned on cello, but the dog we had would howl when I played that, so it was another incentive to play bass in high school. The instruments are similar, but tuned differently. Cello is tuned in fifths, CGDA, like a viola, where a bass is tuned in fourths, EADG, like the four low strings on a guitar. They had more cello players than bass players, so I played in orchestra, symphonic band, and in Rhythm Airs my senior year. I actually did play cello in the Longmont Symphony in 1966 at the first concert they gave. I ended up playing in several local orchestras in this area, mostly on bass, for 40 years. In school, I got more into electronics and metals. I took drafting classes from Mr. Marcantonio, and I won awards 3 years at the CSU Industrial Arts Fair. They gave me the blue ribbon my junior year, and that got my picture in the paper. I took a machine shop class senior year, as they had quite a good vocational shop at the high school. After graduating, I took classes at Metro State to test potential for engineering school. I did well in topics like physics and electric circuits, but decided it would take too long and would cost too much to obtain an engineering degree. I had more of a hands-on interest in the technology that led me to obtain a 2-year degree in it from Community College of Denver in 1971. With the training, I had 3 years of shop training before I ever worked in a shop. We had a class in numerical control at the college, and we had a Moog hydropoint milling machine there, but at that time it used 1-inch paper or mylar punch tape, so our programs had to be entered on a machine like a teletype, and the tape data loaded into the Moog with a tape reader. We had other classes in strength of materials and quality control. I had to take a welding class, too, where I passed certification in two types of arc welding. We welded two plates together and cut them into three parts perpendicular to the weld, which were bent into a U-shape on a press and inspected for cracks. We also had training in oxyacetylene torch welding. I had 3 math classes there. Advanced math wasn't needed for this work, but we did need to know enough algebra to solve basic equations out of the handbook. Machinery's handbook was an essential one to have, and right-angle trigonometry was used the most in shop math. We had an ITW booklet that was used a lot to do the basic trig functions. I had a class in slide rule math at the college, as back then we had no handheld calculators. Those came out in the 1970s, which helped to do the shop math calculations. I took an exam to challenge the drafting class, and I passed that easily. My first job at a shop was making router bits of M2 tool steel at a shop in Longmont down on Grand Avenue. They were blanked out on a Brown & Sharp 2G automatic bar feed lathe. The way that worked was the quarter-inch shank was turned down from a 1/4-inch bar in 2 passes. Smoke rolled off it as it cut with oil flood coolant. Then after that, the parts were machined with various gang milling setups. And after heat treating, they had a few finished grinding operations on grinding equipment. I learned grinding in college, so they had me do that. Centerless grinding on a dead true fixture was used on the shanks. It's a process where the part spins between a grinding wheel and a regulating wheel, and several other setups were used to make them sharp and usable. A Royal Oak cam relieving fixture was used in one setup to give them a cutting edge relief. I ultimately worked in several guys in the shops who had been in the Nazi military in World War II. Our lead man had worked in the Nazi war plants and told of harsh treatment as a youth. Another had been in the Hitler Youth, but was a very nice man who transcended his past. Another guy who had been in the Nazi Navy told me they didn't have draft dodgers there. He said, "They just shot you." Of course, back then, we were in the Vietnam War. I was rated 1A, and the student deferments ended when I was in college, so I was called to Denver for a draft physical, but in a lottery drawing, I was given a high number. One written test they gave us had pictures of tools we were to identify. One was of a 4-jaw lathe chuck. I knew what that was from my training, and afterward, the Army sent me cards in the mail that offered me a special assignment to join up, but I stayed in school to finish my degree. I never served in the military. I worked for Ball Aerospace after that and made parts for the Viking lander that was sent to the planet Mars. Ball made the TV cameras that sent back the first pictures of the service. Not much on Mars. No Martians or monsters. Mostly dust and rocks. I gained experience on an even more diverse set of machines and materials at Ball. It was the first really professional shop where I can learn the most. It was also my first encounter with the ANSI Y14.5 symbology on drawings. It had a concept called true position, with a round tolerance zone, not a square one, and had other specifications related to geometry. In another shop in Longmont on Nelson Road, I worked about a year making prototype parts for IBM and got more into tooling, making punch press dies and inspection fixture. A punch press is a machine that stamps out parts. I had to make a die set with a standard tooling for rubber magnets. It was quite involved with many punches in a punch holder that had to align with the die below. The oblong punches were a purchased component that had to be keyed in position. This required a rotary table I used on a 2J Bridgeport milling machine to bore holes in the punch holder and to mill slots to match in the die. I made a drawing of the design and kept some of the test parts. The rotary table can be moved in degrees of arc with each turn of the crank. The collar is graduated in minutes of arc, and it also has a vernier that gives seconds of arc. I also built a die that they blew up when they tried to punch steel that was too thick. There was a drill fixture I made there too, where holes were coming out wrong due to nickel inclusions in the cast iron they were drilling. It was taken to the plant and measured on a coordinate measuring machine. They said the worst one was out only 1/10,000th of an inch. My boss, Billy, said that didn't happen by accident. But the mills were new, not worn out, and Bridgeport was the world standard machine to do this. We used lathes some on round parts and a service grinder to sharpen dies after heat treating, but work was mostly on mills. I had never built a punch press die before. After the shop on Nelson Road closed, I worked for Dualmatic a few months on their dies. In 1975, I bought a house at 731 Collier on the old east side, and it's on Block 18 where apartments are located on the south end. The old Bryant School had been there, but it was demolished in 1959. We did investigating and found apartments had been built there before the zone allowed it. Longmont did not even have a zoning code until the 1940s. It needed change. I joined a homeowners group to downzone the neighborhood. It was the oldest part of town. The house at 811 Emory is the oldest one sited in the city from 1871. The entire inner city area of Longmont had been upzoned for high-density apartments. The west side had done a downzoning in 1975 to a R1 low-density type of residential zoning. I joined a group of East Side homeowners trying to do the same thing, and we worked with the city to create a new zone for the area they called Residential Low Density Established in 1982. For a presentation to City Council, I wrote a historical study called Longmont's Historic East Side as part of the plan. That resulted in the City Council appointed me to the Landmark Designation Commission. I had done some volunteer work with the St. Vrain Historical Society on a campaign to preserve the old St. Stephen's Church in the 1970s. My mother Evelyn and half-sister Marjorie were also involved. The tool-making experience led me to obtain a job at Waterpik in Fort Collins, making prototype design and build plastic injection molds. My mother saw an ad in the Denver Post, and I applied for it. I had seen some die-casting molds at Dualmatic for Jeep hubs, but I had never made an injection mold before. They had me make a piston mold for a new type of portable Waterpik device, and a gear mold for that. The gear was sent out to another shop to have a gear burned in it with an EDM machine called an electro-discharge machining. It used electrodes of carbon or copper. I made spray ring molds for their shower heads. One was a four-part type, required four different molds for a spray ring assembly. One little acrylic lens mold I made ended up running 750,000 parts because their multi-cavity tool didn't run. This teddy bear mold was a four-cavity type. We had two Arberg mold presses we used to test tooling. We had to run the mold tooling we made on these machines. The tool is designed so it shrinks down on the core and is ejected by an ejection sleeve or pins. The plastic is heated up and injected under pressure in a semi-solid state with the mold closed. Then the mold is cooled by water at a controlled temperature running through water lines. The mold is designed from the part print with the dimensions adjusted by a shrink factor depending on the material. I was in a carpool to Fort Collins with several others. In the summer of 1978, Hewlett-Packard in Loveland had an ad in the newspaper for machine parts inspectors. I took the test they gave as I wanted a job closer to home. I had to inspect a stainless steel part on the service plate for the exam, so I chose a Cadillac gauge and a dial indicator. The gauge is called a height micrometer. I knew what they were, and a dial indicator is a common testing device in the shops. Numbers I gave were good. I was hired for the job on second shift. I was given cross training in the gauge lab and classes in quality control and the ANSI Y14.5 symbology, which was being used there a lot on the precision instrument parts. They had three machine shops I had to monitor with another guy on second shift. They were running several 24-station Bergmaster machining centers on three shifts, along with two CNC lathes to make parts for surveying instruments. Some high-precision parts, like this telescope housing, were also finished machined on jig grinders. They made the lenses there, too. Each CNC machining controller had a HP 9825 desktop calculator that was used to load the program. I had used an NC mill at the school in Denver, but it was just a Moog hydropoint where programs we wrote were on 1-inch punch tape, and at the time CU Boulder was giving a programming class using punched cards. The HP shop setup was the brainchild of house technicians. We had been using a Cordax coordinate measuring machine to do parts inspection, and it had a HP 9830 desktop calculator that loaded and ran programs to roadmaps. I took a class in basic programming to learn more about it. The 9830 had no screen, just a status bar to scroll through the lines of code, and the mass storage was a Philips audio cassette. We could put a disk drive on it for the old 8-inch floppy disks, but the 9830 only had a 16K memory. They did not call it a computer back then. It was a desktop calculator. The inspection group bought a new coordinate measuring machine called a DEA from Italy, and I worked with machine shop technicians to implement a new touch trigger interface. Touch trigger was a new type of real-time probing with the axis moving instead of being still like the old Cordax. And we worked on converting the Cordax code written in BASIC for a newer desktop PC called the 9845B that had a monochrome screen and the same high-speed tape cassettes used in the 9825s they used on the shop CNC controllers. They gave me the job of drawing the new logic diagram to document the project. I designed some inspection tooling fixtures and made drawings. I wrote procedures for the 3820 total station parts the civil engineering division was making in the shop. It was a laser theodolite that had a laser beam it could shoot 3 miles to a retroreflector and calculate distance on its return. It had a keypad and stored data could be downloaded to a data logger to take to an office. This is an actual 3820 total station instrument, like was made at Hewlett-Packard in Loveland. The frame rotates and the telescope can go up and down for the azimuth. It's heavy, it's got a lot of metal in it. We took a field trip to DCD to see a new desktop PC that had faster 16-bit graphics and a product called the 9816. I even bought a Series 80 PC for my own use, and I wrote a program to enter and print out song lead sheets. At the time, we did a lot of HP graphic plotters, and I bought one for my own use. I bought an 86B with a larger screen for text entry of my home writing projects using a text editor. On another project, technicians put a laser on the Moore 3 measuring machine that also had a 9845B computer that I was involved in programming. The laser measurement system was one that Hewlett-Packard manufactured, and it had been used a lot in calibration and the geometric alignment of machine tools. In the 1980s, Hewlett-Packard became known as high-priced, and there was a push to make products more affordable. The surveying line of products was dropped, even though it had been one of Bill Hewlett's ideas, and the LID, Loveland Instrument Division, went to a new key voltmeter, like the 3478, where the circuit board components were loaded with an auto-insert machine and wave-soldered. The loaded board was tested and sent down the line to a worker who put it together as a kit. This caused a great change at HP Loveland and in the business. I obtained a state vocational credential to teach in 3 topics, machine shop, drafting, and computer programming. To expand my knowledge of electronics, I took the Heath Zenith classes. I built 2 color TV set kits and audio gear. They had scrap parts auctions at HP, and I bought 2 older oscilloscopes that helped me with the studies. My last 5 years at HP were in printed circuit process engineering, where I worked on bed of nails testing, such as the Finstrate process, copper core PC boards that also had a heat sink. I worked on bed of nails fixtures that could test whole PCB panels. The panels had many small circuit boards that were cut out with a CNC router, and panels could be laminated with many layers. I worked with lamination press handling and design of a new type of 18 by 24 inch size panel imaging. I worked with board solder mask imaging that included rebuilding their silk screen nomenclature process. But in 1986, the HP Loveland plant began to outsource many processes as parts were being sent out. The printed circuit operation was sold to an outfit in Kansas, and my job was eliminated. It was said to be the largest Hewlett-Packard plant at 1 million square feet in 4 buildings. I was a tour guide there. It was sad to see it go, but my career was taking another turn. In music, I did not play in orchestras from 1974 to 1985. Working nights and working out of town make that difficult. I began recording song demos on a 4-track open reel recorder in the late 1970s. I learned guitar, learned piano, and I worked with synthesizers. years. I learned more about music by doing that then than I ever did by playing in orchestras. But I bought a bass and went back to playing that in the LSO in 1985. It led me to record the LSO concerts. I took a voluntary severance incentive buyout from HP and decided to seek work more close to home in the winter of 1986 and 1987. I saw an ad at job service for a temporary machinist at the National Bureau of Standards in Boulder. I was hired there as a machinist premium journeyman in 1987, and I built some interesting gear like a moon tracker for NOAA. I worked with Ryan Sanders on that, which they planned to take to Antarctica for ozone depletion experiments. He sent me a postcard from McMurdo Bay saying it worked well. The scope had been made on a Monarch EE lathe. It was an old Monarch with a vacuum tube drive, but it did the job. They also had a 24-inch swing gap bed Leblon lathe. It had a 9-inch hole through the spindle and a 20-horsepower motor. Chucks had to be mounted with the overhead crane. I ran it with a 4-jaw on the front and a 3-jaw on the back. It was much like this newer machine shown in action. I used it to machine large brass covers they wanted made for the microcalorimeters, instruments they put in a water bath for temperature cooling, to measure microwave energy dissipated in a standard. The big lathe could cut covers faster than a smaller machine. In 1987, my half-sister Marjorie died of cancer. She had been a reporter and a librarian in Bloomington, and she knew the most about a family ancestor, Vinnie Ream, who I had heard about, so I decided to take up the research Marge had started. That would turn into a 10-year odyssey done along with my regular employment. I began writing to the historical agencies asking for more information. Few books existed on the artist. The U.S. Capitol Historical Society sent me a notice about research fellowships, so I sent them a proposal about writing a new kind of illustrated biography about the artist. I asked for $9,000, and they gave me $3,000, but it was enough to do the initial research. I went to Washington, D.C. and met the Society President, Fred Twingle. The Vinnie Ream items had been sent to Oklahoma, Missouri, Wisconsin, and Iowa after her death in 1914. The Society money helped me travel to several states and to Washington, D.C., where most of the family papers were stored. After about 9 months in the Bureau Standards shop, a microwave metrology group was seeking a technician to bring their dimensional measurements lab into the modern world. They learned that I had worked on dimensional metrology at Hewlett-Packard. The job was advertised in Commerce Business Daily, and I was hired. They said I was the most qualified, so I became an engineering technician. I brought in a Metatoya coordinate measuring machine from Gaithersburg, added digital voltmeters to their pneumatic air gauge system, and added a 9845B to do the computer data acquisition. I also obtained a Zygo laser micrometer from the main NIST lab in Gaithersburg to measure small wire sizes. I mounted a linear stage and a lead screw on it that would advance at 1/10 of an inch increments, along with a Silvac scale for digital data acquisition a computer could read. I tried a 9845C in the lab that had a color screen, and I ended up with a Series 9236 desktop PC in the lab that also ran EGS, the engineering graphics system for drawings. Software had to be written to do the data acquisition from the digital voltmeters, to save and retrieve data for calculations, and to plot graphs in color on a graphics plotter, or be output to a printer for reports and documentation. It had to be able to include data from diverse sources for the reports. Plots could be displayed on the screen, stored on a disk, sent to a printer, or plotted out on a graphics plotter. Red and green screen colors on the graphs show two passes through a device of the two jet air probe rotated 90 degrees that could detect two-point elliptical lobing. We had three jet air gauging rings for the wire-like interconductors that could detect three-point lobing, common in fabricating a small diameter, as it can't be detected with a two-point measuring device like a micrometer. The system could also plot a single red line for air ring data and plot a black line of data from a laser micrometer. Air gauging measures back pressure from a precision probe and converted it to voltages on a gauge amplifier using a bellows-type LVDT linear variable differential transformer. Calibration of the system was done with ring gauges or pin gauges of known size and roundness, and certified by other labs to traceable standards. To measure a 7mm bore, for example, we had three master ring gauges, a high limit, a low limit, and a center 7mm, which was 0.27559-inch diameter. The low limit was 0.27549-inch, and the high limit was 0.27569-inch diameter. These ring gauge standards were probed on the air gauge to set high, low, and center readings on the gauge amplifier. So it was measuring 7mm plus or minus 1/10,000th of an inch through a 7mm bore. Size was not shown in metric because gauges were English. The graph shows two passes through the device bore, shown in red and green, rotated 90 degrees, and the average size is calculated, which in this case was 0.27564 inches. It is outputting a voltage from the gauge amplifier to a digital voltmeter. The 3478 DVM works like an A-to-D converter, taking analog voltage and converting it to digital. This is one of the 3478 digital voltmeters. Connections were made on the back. Port back here is a HPIB. You could connect a cable, interface it to a computer. I measured length and diameter of precision coaxial air lines in the lab used for microwave devices and calibration of automatic network analyzer. I used the Mitutoya CMM and a TriMOS height gauge for lengths. Both had a resolution of plus or minus 1 micrometer, or about 40 millionths of an inch. The diameters of the device bore and linear conductor wire were measured on the air gauge or the Zygo to a resolution of plus or minus 20 millionths of an inch or plus or minus 0.5 micrometer. To compare air gauge results to a coordinate measuring machine in Gaithersburg, I took a test device there that had a distinctive air form, and we ran measurements on an Apollo CMM that recorded data I could compare to the Boulder NIST lab testing. The blue line on this graph shows how Apollo multipoint diameters compared to two passes with the air gauge shown in red and green. The average of all three is about the same, which shows functional results agree that differ due to geometry. Roundness graphs show how these two passes vary. The CMM is programmed to probe multiple points around the bore diameter on many diameters along the length. The air gauge was also used to measure waveguide that had a rectangular inner profile that required special probes to be made to fit the slot with minimal clearance. Temperature control was held to 68 degrees Fahrenheit, plus or minus 1/4 degree, and graphed on the Honeywell controller. This control was needed to minimize the effect of thermal expansion on length measurements to work at the international standard temperature that is commonly used as various materials expand at different rates. The coordinate measuring machine was used to do direct probing of device lengths that were compared to lengths obtained with the TriMAS height gauge with tooling for a functional inspection. The numbers and graphs were summarized in a report the engineers prepared in the Wing 6 lab upstairs. The process was described in a paper I wrote that I gave at the Anaheim Measurement Sciences Conference in 1993. In 1998, I gave a talk at a meeting of the National Conference of Standards and Laboratory at Hewlett-Packard in the Denver Tech Center. One of the HP people at the session said he had never seen anything presented on the dimensional technology before. I talked about how roundness and surface finish can affect uncertainty about size that may require a better kind of analysis, such as a least squares analysis that would be obtained from probing multi-points on a diameter probed on a coordinate measuring machine. We also had a Mondo camera for the CMM that could do non-contact visual probing of diameters. I did other machining jobs in the main shop as one of the few technicians qualified to work in there. I worked with Rob Bellinger on a new radiometer test system design. He designed parts on a CAD system, and I built them out of stainless steel. In the shop, we used a wire EDM machine to cut the switch block out of solid stainless. I cleaned up the center on a hard-inch lathe, used a service grinder to clean up the sides, and I milled the pockets on an easy-track Bridgeport. Pockets for the connector on each side of the cube were programmed on the easy-track using CAN modes. It was also used to mill a circular path for water cooling channels in the cube and base plates. Another shop job I did was a wafer probing station for a scientist where I had to design it a lot as I went along working from simple sketches. Other parts that I designed and built were parts for a leveling table for the 6-port microwave test systems. I made CAD drawings we could send out to outside vendor shops. Hollywood used HP computers and movies to generate graphics. The 9845B was used in Raise the Titanic in 1983, and the 9845C was used to do the graphics for the film War Games, also made in 1983. They did not use a graphics display in War Games, but instead filmed the computer screen on movie film and projected it on several rear projection screens to create the large color displays in the war room scenes. The job lasted 16 years in Boulder, until the RIF of 2003. Now I've been told they don't even have a shop there now. I was invited back to an alumni event in 2004. I have my own shop equipment that has kept me in the shop business to some extent. I have used it to do special jobs on request and make custom camera mounts and equipment from my own AV projects. One project was to convert a 1940 string bass to a 5-string in 2013. I bought the instrument at an auction for $100. There is a video on YouTube showing how that was done. The writing began when I was working at HP writing inspection procedures. I wrote some articles for publications like PC Panoramics, and printed circuit fabrication, and I did more of that at NBS NIST, writing inspection procedures and documenting lab systems. On the Landmark Designation Commission, I wrote landmark designation reports on buildings. That resulted in writing a few National Register nomination forms on the Callahan House and the old fire station. As Landmark Commission Chairman, I was the guy who had to talk to City Council about preservation. In 1992, I wrote another nomination for the old 1912 Carnegie Library when city factions were split on preserving the old building as part of a new library expansion. One thing that may have helped Carnegie was the Keith Ames Library Wing, built in Project 75 20 years earlier, was demolished at a cost of almost $250,000 to make room for a library expansion project. Designers they hired proposed a new building and not using the Keith Ames structure. This caused a lot of anger and controversy. The city council was even surprised. I resigned from the city commission and applied to the Boulder County Board called HPAB. I joined a coalition called CORE, Citizens Opposed to Removal of Public Structures. The group did an ordinance by initiative to save the Carnegie Building, and we did a successful petition drive, but it was put on the 1993 ballot where it failed by 62 votes. But the 1993 election also created some turnover on council that gave it 4 votes to save the Carnegie. So City Council voted to keep it in 1994 and renovate it using grants like I had proposed. An analysis of the election showed the 62 dissenting votes had come from fringe areas, and the wards nearest to the Carnegie and the inner city neighborhoods had voted to keep the building, showing support of the inner city. My writing about the family ancestor progressed on women sculptor Vinnie Rehm. She had obtained a commission from Congress to make a statue of Lincoln for the Capitol Rotunda at the age of 18 in 1866. She was the first woman and the youngest artist to receive such a commission, quite a notable achievement. But in doing a lit search, I could find no books about the lady that really told her story well or showed her work. The work I was doing was featured in an article in the DOC publication Commerce People. Local publisher Jack Hofer and I created a 440-page book that has 220 illustrations that was printed in 1997. It was printed in Michigan, but was a product of local Boulder County talent. I ended up doing the technical postscript troubleshooting myself to print the galley proofs. I began entering text on an HP 86B in a simple text editor, then transferred it to WordStar after I bought a laptop PC that had that software. Then I gave files to Jack, who did the layout in Ventura 5. Bob Schramm of Bookends in Boulder did the cover graphics and jacket design in Freehand 5. When initial book sales were not great, I made a 1-hour video documentary, and I got a deal with CEN, the Central Educational Network, to run it through the PBS television affiliate subnetworks in 2002. It did run on some of the PBS stations, such as KLCS Los Angeles in prime time, WNYE New York, KRMA Denver, KLRU Austin, and KUED in Salt Lake, among others. The video is on YouTube now at the High Country Media channel. It was hard work, but I learned a lot. It was the first video I had really made on a nonlinear editing system, which at that time was a DPS perception. The video was transferred from the computers to a Betacam SP videotape that was sent to the uplink for distribution to the PBS subnetwork. I was told that Vinnie was not well known enough to justify what I was trying to do, And another asked, "Why didn't you write about someone more famous?" But the world didn't need more books about the more famous. This is what was needed. I did not have a profit motive. It was an interesting story that deserved more attention. Along with playing contrabass in orchestras for years, I began recording concerts in 1987. Antonia Wilson asked some of us to play at her PhD recital at CU Boulder that summer. I asked if I could record the recital. Antonia liked the results. Dr. Olson heard it and asked me to record the LSO concerts. I ultimately recorded LSO 35 years and the CU Mahlerfest 17 years, along with recording other concerts for the Jefferson Symphony, Boulder Symphonia, and I did some recording at Betcher and another concert for Antonia, doing audio for the Colorado Institute of Art. That one had Leatherman Larry Green narrating Verdi Hymn of the Nations. It's been an interesting career. I got to do many interesting things. But I made the effort to seek opportunities and learn the technology. It can be tough, but I think that's how we grow.